started.
Charles, don't creep yourself. Jin, stop fighting. Jin? 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 Carl, stop crippling yourself.
Oh.
Archie, if you don't join right now, I'm going to
yell at you. Oh, hurry up!
Oh, there's Jared getting attacked. Ow! What the hell?
Run! Hey!
What?
Fight me later. We need to survive.
Oh, stop.
Charles, yeah. Stop farting.
Such a big letdown, I need to put you into the time. Think back to the late 80s, and if you weren't there, then just try to imagine. Ninja Turtles were the fucking shit. And I mean, they were awesome. Every kid I knew couldn't get enough of them, even though it was everywhere. There were video games, comics, action figures, and of course, the cartoon series. In 1990, all this turtle craze would soar to a higher level. This is when we were given the first big screen live-action Ninja Turtle movie. Taglines would say things like lean green and on the screen, and hey dudes, this is no cartoon. I was 10 and I can't even describe in words how psyched I was. This was like the big kid version of Ninja Turtles. It was rated PG, it was dark, a little violent. The turtles talked like adults using words like damn.
Just let me ninja kick the damn rabbit. Damn, come back here, I'm not finished with you. Damn,
the battle scenes got us all pumped up. And for guys in costumes, it was a...
I'm not finished with you! Damn!
Battle suits got us all pumped up. And for guys in costumes, it was a pretty great display of physical talent and fight choreography, not to mention those awesome turtle moves. I think of this movie as the end of the 80s and the beginning of the 90s. I can't think of another film at the time that had such a big impact on the youth, and it just reeked of the culture. There was skateboarding, video games, bubblegum, and kids with cigars. Well, bottom line, it was the definitive turtle movie. Never did I expect another. It ends with the classic confrontation of Splinter and Shredder. much like Obi-Wan and Darth Vader. When they find out who Shredder really is, Splinter flips him over the rail where he falls to his doom. The Foot Clan falls, everything's resolved at the end, all the loose ends tied. There's no way there'd be a sequel, right? Well, the next year, to my surprise, there was Ninja Turtles 2, The Secret of the Ooze. The jokes were cornier, the fighting scenes were stupider. In what seems like an attempt to tone down the violence, the Turtles, they use all kinds of silly objects as weapons. And besides, they never say damn anymore. But regardless, it had all us kids going crazy. It felt like it was a necessary sequel so it advanced the story further. And it pit the Turtles up against other mutants made by the same ooze that mutated them. So, they like met their match. In the first movie, they only fought humans, but during the cartoon, they were fighting all kinds of other mutant characters. So we thought that this was going to be the live-action version of Bebop and Rocksteady. What we got instead were two new characters named Toka and Razor. Nevertheless, all my friends at school still called them Bebop and Rocksteady, even though it's kind of obvious that Bebop and Rocksteady were rhinoceros and a warthog, while Toka and Razor were a snapping turtle and a wolf. Well, that's true, but the real reason a lot of us called him Bebop and Rocksteady was because we were attached
real
to the series and the line of action figures. So we wanted the movies to represent those characters. So now that Ninja Turtles sequel existed, we knew at this point that there was going to be another. This wasn't
Luke
Percy,
this
was
going to
be a series.
Because
and we would get to see live action incarnations of many of our favorite characters yet to come. Or maybe not. We had to wait another 2 years before another Ninja Turtle movie was finally announced. So we're thinking, well, because they're taking so much longer on this one, it's going to be incredible. I remember actually having dreams about going to see Turtles 3 and then waking up and being pissed off that it wasn't real. The wait was fucking killing me. There's already a third Ninja Turtles game on Nintendo, The Manhattan Project. Would that be the subtitle of the movie too? My friends and I all debated what it would be. Would it be Ninja Turtles 3, The Advent of Krang, Ninja Turtles 3, The Revenge of Shredder, Ninja Turtles 3, Enter Dimension X, Ninja Turtles 3, Here Comes the Technodrome. No, we were far off. It was like landing on the zero in roulette. Everyone fucking loses. The movie had no subtitle at all. While today, whenever I bring up the film, often people insist that there was a subtitle, Turtles in Time. But to clear that up once and for all, Turtles in Time was the name of the video game, and it had nothing to do with that awful movie. Yes, in the movie they go back in time, but it's to ancient Japan, while in the game they go back to several different times, as well as the future. It was the second Turtles game in the arcade, and it was also on Super Nintendo, known as Turtles 4. But back to my question, why was there no subtitle in the movie? They subtitled the last movie. Well, I have an answer. Look under that title. You see that blank, empty space? Let that be an indication of the blank, empty imagination employed within, and the void it left in our hearts. So who's the villain in this movie? Is it going to be Krang? Since even the first movie, we've been hoping for him, aside from Shredder, main villain in the show. So, will it be A, Krang, B, Baxter Stockman, C, the Rat King, D, Leatherhead, E, all the above? Well, the answer is none of the above. The answer is just a big fuck you to all the kids who are waiting so anxiously to see their favorite characters on the big screen. And you think, well, Shredder's gotta be in it, right? Nope, not even him. Well, there's even more reason to bring him back, because at the end of Turtles 2, Shredder uses the last vial of turn himself into Super Shredder. Now, Super Shredder was awesome because he was like a monster, but you only see a little bit of him since he's under the dock, all shrouded in darkness. There's no way the Turtles can even fight him. Remember back in the first movie, they couldn't even beat regular Shredder. Splinter had to take him out. And at this time, in anticlimactic end, Shredder does himself in by ripping apart the dock. Now, think about this. Would he really die by having a dock collapse on him? In the first movie, he falls into a garbage truck. Casey Jones activates the compactor and crushes the fuck out of him. Now, he comes back in the second movie alive and well. Now, if he can survive that, why can't he survive some falling beams of wood? And besides, this time he's Super Shredder. Wouldn't you have liked to see Super Shredder come back in Turtles 3? Well, that's what I was hoping for. But too bad. Make way for this samurai and this guy on a horse. Yeah. These are our villains of Turtles 3, Norinaga and Walker. I've never heard of them before. Now, you have this huge stockpile of memorable villains from the comics, the TV series, the video games, the action figures, all that, and they just go ahead and bring in two uninspired, stereotyped, mediocre villains. I mean, come on! This is the best they could come the start is the beginning. The first two movies open in New York City, which worked really well. It puts you in the right atmosphere, you get a sense of the environment, the crime that's going on, and it just builds up to the Turtles' first appearance. Seeing the movies as a kid, it was like, they're coming any minute. But the third movie begins in ancient Japan, and you know that at this point, it doesn't have anything to do with the Turtles yet. You're just watching some pointless scene with samurais on a horse. Do you feel like you're watching a Ninja Turtles movie? No, you don't. You feel like you're watching some cliche samurai.
Could this be
any more stock? Maybe if they made it take place in the Old West instead and they begin with a train robbery, that's the only way it could be more shallow. Then what happens? He uses a subway train as a transition like we've never seen that, and it cuts to the sewers. And of course, now the Turtles abruptly show up, but take a look back at how the last two movies revealed it. In the first Turtle movie, we don't see them right away. First, we see a weapon smash out the streetlight, which we can identify as Raphael's side. Then we see nothing but darkness, but we can hear the Turtles beating up the bad guys. Next, we see a little glimpse from the sewer. Then we see their shadows, and we know at this moment that right when they come around that corner, we are about to see for the first time the live-action Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles on the big screen. But no, wait, in mid-jump, the title screen comes up, and then the suspense is delayed even further. Come on, come on. Yeah, look at that. It's awesome. Totally radical. Now that's how you do it. Now let's take a look at the second movie now. It's a little more abrupt, but it works in a different sort of way. This one doesn't rely on suspense, or at least not in the same way. You can say that you're already in suspense as soon as the movie begins. I know I was. I mean, you're thinking, come on, where's the Turtles? Who's this guy fighting the bad guys? We don't want him, we want the Turtles. And then when those thugs all gang up on him, we know he's in deep shit. And what better time than now? There they are, in the background, out of focus. And one in which Michelangelo's involved. And that pissed me off, because he was my favorite turtle. Some of the concepts are just ridiculous. Like when April's thrown in the dungeon, she looks over at the guy next to her and she says, Casey! Okay, so you're saying that Casey Jones had an ancestor in Japan? Well, even if I'm gonna accept that, why does she call him Casey? Like he's gonna respond? And then, just to push this scene over the edge of mockery, they have this rat creeping. And April says,
Now you look familiar too.
What? You don't mean... Oh my god, they do. Club scene. So, that's five battles, and four of which have all the turtles. In Turtles 3, there's a fight in the dungeon with no Michelangelo. Anyway, that's one. Then there's the fight at the river. Again, no Michelangelo, so that's two. Then there's the final fight with all the turtles. So only three battles in the whole movie, and only one in which Michelangelo's involved. And that pissed me off, because he was my favorite turtle. Some of the concepts are just ridiculous. Like when April's thrown in the dungeon, she looks over at this guy next to her and she says,
Casey?
Okay, so you're saying that Casey Jones had an ancestor in Japan? Well, even if I'm gonna accept that, why does she call him Casey? Like he's gonna respond? And then, just to push this scene over the edge of mockery, they have this rat creeping. And April says,
Now you look familiar too.
What? You don't mean... Oh my god, they do. I swear, I didn't make this edit. The movie actually fades from the rat river. Again, no Michelangelo, so that's two. Then there's the final fight with all the turtles. So only three battles in the whole movie, and only one in which Michelangelo's involved. And that pissed me off, because he was my favorite turtle. Some of the concepts are just ridiculous. Like when April's thrown in the dungeon, she looks over at this guy next to her and she says,
Casey?
Okay, so you're saying that Casey Jones had an... That's two. Rap in the Junkyard, three. Then rescuing Rap in the Junkyard, base of Token Rather, four. Then the final club scene. So, that's five battles, and four of which have all the turtles. In Turtles 3, they fight the dungeon with no Michelangelo. Anyway, that's one. Then there's the fight at the river. Again, no Michelangelo, so that's two. Then there's the final fight with all the turtles. So, only three battles in the whole movie, and only one in which Michelangelo's involved. And that pissed me off, because he was my favorite turtle. Some of the concepts are just ridiculous. Like when April's thrown in the dungeon, she looks over at this guy next to her and she says,
Casey?
Okay, so you're saying that Casey Jones had an ancestor? In Turtles 3, there's a fight in the dungeon with no Michelangelo. Anyway, that's one. Then there's the fight at the river. Again, no Michelangelo, so that's two. Then there's the turtle. Some of the concepts are just ridiculous. Like when April's thrown in the dungeon, she looks over at this guy next to her and she says,
Casey?
Okay, so you're saying that Casey Jones had an ancestor? Well, even if I'm gonna accept that, why does she call him Casey? Like he's gonna respond? And then, just to push this scene over the edge of mockery, they have this rat creeping. And April says,
now you look familiar too.
What? You don't mean... Oh my god, they do. I swear I didn't make this edit. The movie actually fades from the rat to Splinter, implying that that rat is Splinter's ancestor. Now, April never ceases to amaze me. Of course the fucking rat looks familiar. It's a rat. I can't tell one rat from another. And of all the rats that could be crawling around that dungeon, how does that one just happen to be it? And I gotta say, all the planets must have lined up. April meets both Casey and Splinter's ancestor in a matter of seconds. And I can accept Splinter because it's Japan and that's where he's from. But both of them? That's the biggest fucking coincidence I ever heard in my life. You know what other part I can't stand? This. That turtle duck thing is really getting old. I mean, it was cool the first time, but geez, it's enough of that shit. So is there anything I like? Well, I kind of hate to admit it, but when they're dancing a Tarzan boy, that's the highlight of the movie. All the turtle movies are full of bad jokes and constant references to movies or TV shows, but this one just takes it another step to absurdity.